Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you again for joining us, one of the OSCG, Osgoode Society for Corporate Governance events. As you know, we are a student-run organization, and we try to put together events that raises more awareness about what corporate governance is. And we do have a website. You can learn more about us from www.oscg.com. Today, we are so excited and thankful to Professor Vermeulen. I hope I have said that right.
That's perfect.
For being here today. As I read you his credentials, you will agree with me that he's a super, super researcher and professor. And we are so thankful that you're here with us today. So here I go with his list of credentials. He is a professor of business and financial law at Tilburg University and Tilburg Law and Economic Center in the Netherlands. He's also the director of the International Business Law Program at University of Tilburg and has taught about corporate governance and venture capital all over the world, from the Netherlands to Belgium to Colombia to Japan and so on. He is the senior counsel corporate as well as vice president at the corporate legal department of Philips International BV in the Netherlands, where he advises on corporate governance issues, including the global corporate structure of the Philips group of companies. He has extensive experience in mergers and acquisitions, corporate finance projects, and general corporate and securities law matters. He has worked on national and international projects for organizations such as the European Commission, OECD, the Dutch Development Finance Institution, and local governments in the Netherlands concerning financial and venture capital markets, corporate law, and corporate governance. He is the founding council member of the International Venture Club, which is a collaborative platform that brings together risk capital providers that aim to support small and medium-sized enterprises, the SMEs, in their efforts to achieve their full growth and potential. He has written extensively in the area of corporate and partnership law, corporate governance, joint ventures, venture capital, and innovation. His current research looks at corporate governance, value creation, and innovation to understand the role of corporate governance in promoting the competitiveness and innovative capacity of both listed and non-listed companies. So ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome Professor Vermeulen.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you. We're going to move this. Yeah, we put it like this. Okay, thank you all for coming. As was said, I'm right now doing some research on corporate governance and trying to link it to innovation and value creation, which is new. The reason that I do it, I'm both practitioner and academic, and I'm kind of tired of the corporate governance research that we see now and the presentations that we hear. So I want to do something completely new. And when I'm at Philips, I know how these organizations work, and I don't really recognize what we find in the paper. So I thought, okay, we have to do something about it, but that's not easy. So we use an example, and the example is Facebook. And this is based on, the whole presentation is based on a paper that will be published in, I hope, next month. Together with my co-author, Joe McCary, who is an American. And he's also very excited about the project. And whenever I teach it and I mention the word Facebook to students, they all wake up. Because probably that's what they were doing before I was actually mentioning Facebook. They were on Facebook. So they say, how does he know that we're on Facebook? So Facebook, everybody wants to know about Facebook. So the question that we ask ourselves during this talk is, should Facebook's governance structures scare investors? The first thing I always do is ask the question, who likes Facebook? I'm not going to do it here, but when I ask this question to my students, it's 90% that not like it, they love it. They think it's great, they can use it to share information, to share pictures, to do assignments together. 10% do not really like it for privacy reasons, or they broke up with their girlfriend or boyfriend because of Facebook. Because boyfriend or girlfriend was jealous because the other one was on Facebook, so all these pictures, oh my God, that cannot be right. So you get some suspicion. So you have 90% that actually really like it. So then the question is, do investors like it? And before the IPO, they seem to love it because we have this very high price at the IPO in May 2012. And there were already some newspaper articles in February 2012 that warned the investors, say, okay, long-term investors, you should be worried about Facebook's lack of board diversity. There were no women on the board, that was what it meant. Or Mark Zuckerberg is in total control. But still, investors did not seem to worry too much. But then immediately after the IPO, the stock price went down. And the stock price performance of Facebook was really not good. And corporate governance experts said, you see, we are right. Facebook's ownership structure should scare investors more than the botched IPO. And things went down and down. Stock price continues to disappoint. So the corporate governance experts again said, you see, everything is wrong. We should look at the principal agent problem. It should be reduced. Mark Zuckerberg is in total control. That cannot be right. You should sell. But now, all of a sudden, we are in November 2012. Price is going up slightly. We're not there yet. I think the highest here was something like a bit more than 30 US dollars. But it's going there. And some now argue, you see, Mark Zuckerberg should not be too worried about all the criticism. He should just do what he is supposed to do, think about the long term, and then things will go better and the investors might also be happy again. The interesting thing that happened is that when the lockup period expired, people expected when the lockup period expired, all the insiders could sell even more shares, and they all expected that they would do it, so the share price would go down even further, but they didn't. And now some of the investors started to think, if they are not going to sell, maybe they still believe in their company. So share price goes up a bit. Then we see that somewhere here we get the financial results of the fourth quarter. And that was not particularly good. And that's what you see here. The stock price drops again. But then the long-term investors start to rethink, because Facebook did solve some problems with their advertisement, mobile advertisement. And then they said, okay, Facebook announced that they have to make more investments, so they will not be really profitable, but these investments are needed in order to secure future growth. This is important, so it's about future growth, and the investors actually liked it. And the long-term investors, because they stayed, share price goes up again. So now the question again is, do we like or dislike Facebook, and what should investors do? Well, we will focus on the governance structure. If we just look at the governance structure of Facebook, should investors walk away or should they just stay, because this might be the best possible governance structure at this moment? That's the question. Now, when we take a closer look at the governance structure, we see it's Mark Zuckerberg everywhere. First, he owns dual class shares. He has the class B shares of Facebook. So 80% of the outstanding shares are owned by Zuckerberg, so he's a minority shareholder. However, because of the dual class structure, he owns 57%. He has shares that offer 10 votes per share instead of the one vote per share. So that's one thing, he's in total control. Then we look at the board. First, they have a classified board, which basically means that these board members will serve different terms. And they will not be elected every year. So whenever somebody else will control Facebook, it will take a while before they get rid of the whole board. That's problem number two, according to the corporate governance experts. The other thing is, when you look at the board, it's kind of clubby. It's all friends. They all have the similar views. She is also the COO and is an officer. And she was appointed because they wanted to deal with the diversity issue. They said, okay, we need more women on the board. Hey, we have a chief operating officer. Let's appoint on the board. And she's very much into promoting women at very high positions in companies. So that's also pretty good strategy. However, she's an insider. Then we look at the independent directors, and what we see is they are also venture capitalists, so they invested heavily in Facebook. So they are independent, but still they have something to lose, big time, because they invested in it. This is the guy that started Netflix. So he's an entrepreneur. And here we have one politician, at least he's very active in politics, and a publisher. So he is about networks, what Facebook is about. So he knows about the business. We do not see many accountants and other financial experts on this board, and that might worry investors. Actually, there are some articles written on this. So it's very clubby. They all have the same entrepreneurial Silicon Valley view. And maybe because now it's it might have worked in a non-listed situation, but now they did the IPOs, you have many retail investors and other investors, maybe this should change. And then he is a CEO, but he's also the chairman of the board, and that's, of course, from a principal agent point of view, is not right, because now he's controlling and monitoring himself. So is this good or bad? Well, we have different views here. Entrepreneurs in the Valley love him for this. And here you see Mr. Allison. He's the founder of Oracle. And he said during this nice interview, tech moguls like Larry Page, Sergey Brin, these are Google, and Mark Zuckerberg, run public companies that are essentially private fiefdom. So they run them as they are still in control, like a private company. And they have structured their corporate control so there's no way that investors or board members can unsee them. Thanks Steve Jobs for this. And what you see right now is there's a trend. You see two trends in corporate governance. One, for public corporations, investors get more control, more investor-friendly rules and arrangements. On the other hand, when we talk about fast-growing startup companies, we see that they more and more are going to use dual-class shares. They have classified boards. They are in control almost everywhere. And the reason is, one, they know what happened with Steve when he was fired by the board of Apple. And then he came back and we were all happy because I'm an Apple. Oh man, I'm a huge fan of Apple. So I'm really happy that he came back. But he said in this interview, and you can check it out on the internet, that that was the biggest mistake that Apple made in the past, that they fired Steve, because Steve was Apple. And we should learn from this, and that's why we see more of these companies like Groupon, Zynga, Facebook that we discussed, but also LinkedIn, and we're going to coming back to LinkedIn later, they all are in total control. You see some comparisons with what happened in 2000 and 2012. We see also here, you see 6.4% were using dual class shares. Right now it's 13.8%, so we see an increase. So it's opposite to the trend that we see in public companies, if we talk about these high-tech startups that do an IPO. So they like Facebook very much because of this. And they say you should not change. Then we have the other group. And these are what I call corporate governance experts, but also practitioners and, what's even worse, lawmakers and regulators. They say what happens at Facebook is actually bad. And here we see Professor Babchuk of Harvard. And he runs this group and he is all again, you know, he's all in favor of changing the boards and get rid of classified boards. So boards should be elected every year. So there's more pressure on them. We can monitor them closely. So more power and control for the investors. Some other corporate governance experts like the ISS as a proxy advisor, they say, okay, investor group to exchanges, stop dual class listings. They are bad. And they have some empirical research, which is kind of weird when you really read it. But there's this conclusion, the worst companies, the worst performing companies are those with total protection from shareholder pressure. And these are the companies with dual class shares. So we should get rid of it. And they do not like Facebook. They dislike it at every level. Shareholders level, the fact that he is also the CEO and chair, classified boards, and this kind of clubby, not really strong, independent directors that control Mark Zuckerberg, that are actually not his friends. But according to them, you should have more independent people that check him and control him all the time. And the reason why they do this, and probably you know this, is because they focus on the principal agent problem. When we talk about corporate governance, it's always about reducing principal agent problems or reducing information asymmetries. So here we see typical company, we have some shareholders, non-executive directors and executive directors, the managers, and here we have some other stakeholders. But basically what corporate governance is about, we should have shareholder-friendly rules and arrangements. So more control here, and if they cannot have control, we need strong independent directors that are actually going to do the work for them. So this is in a US-style situation where you have dispersed ownership. When they do this talk in Europe, they will immediately say, yeah, listen, this is not a European situation. In Europe, we have controlling shareholders, like in Germany, in Belgium, in Italy. And then we have this situation. Now, corporate governance is not so much about aligning the interest of the managers with the interest of the shareholders. It's more about making sure that the minority shareholders will not be pushed out by controlling shareholders. And then we talk about related party transactions and exploiting corporate opportunities by controlling shareholders. How can you deal with this? Well, again, independent directors play a very important role. And that's what we see here. This is probably one of the best books written on corporate law and corporate governance. Yes, right? According to most. And this book is pretty cheap. You can buy it like just paperback, and it's good. All the big names are in there, like Krackman, Hansman, John Armour, Paul Davies, Luis Enriquez, etc. And it's interesting when you read it, because when you read the sections of corporate governance, it actually shows that it's all about the principal agent problem. And they, just to get you back, they define basically three principal agent problems. One, between the managers and the shareholders. Number two, controlling shareholders, minority shareholders. Number three, the company itself and its stakeholders. And all the rules that we make, corporate law, should be focused on dealing with these problems. We should reduce these problems. That's the only thing that matters. And then what you get is these are basically the conclusions that they have. We need small and declassified boards. They are always better. More independent directors is better. Independent chairman is better. Gender diversity is crucial. It's not in this book because it's too old to cover the gender diversity discussion. But I can tell you this will be one of the discussions. We need gender diversity. So in Europe, we are thinking about a rule that obliges the companies to have 40% women on the board. Corporate governance is to engage long-term shareholders and investors, and what should they focus on? Well, on the remuneration. That's one of the key things, of course. So how much get these guys paid? And on related party transactions. Basically, we need one share, one vote, so no dual class shares, because, you know, that's much better, and it gives more power to investors. And the result is one size fits all. I don't buy that one size fits all at all, because they don't look at different stages, different phases, young companies, very old companies, more than 100 years old, family-controlled companies versus widely dispersed. Also the sectors they ignore, whether it's a pharmaceutical company or an electronic company or computers. It's all the same to them, one size fits all. So when you read this, and maybe you have already an idea, should Mark Zuckerberg, in order to create more shareholder value, should he change the corporate governance structure? That's the main question. Whenever you read these books, the answers will be yes. That's the first thing he should do. He makes a mistake by keeping this kind of control in Facebook. He's a listed company now. He should realize that. He should act as one. Would I recommend him to change immediately? I can ask the question to you. Would you recommend him to change? I did this in Tilburg. I'm a professor at Tilburg University, and I asked these students, they had an assignment, Facebook, what should they change? And I told them if it was a very good recommendation, I would send it to him. I didn't send anything to him. But what would you do? Would you recommend him to change? Or should he just do the thing that he's doing right now in order, because that's the counter argument, he's in total control, so he doesn't care too much about the stock price. He doesn't care too much about short-term pressures of the stock market. So basically, he protected himself and he can just think about this product, make it more perfect, so even more people will enjoy it, and even more opportunities will come out of Facebook. That's the thing, that's the question. Well, I will give you the answer. I don't think he will immediately change. And the reasons are, it might destruct value. If he's going to change and if he's going to be organized as most listed companies. And in order to show you where the value destruction comes from, I have first an explanation and a couple of cases. So this is what he might argue. Okay, we have corporate governance, we have the rules, we have the arrangements. And if you go back in time, you see whenever there was a scandal or whenever there's a crisis, lawmakers and the experts react. And what you get is, this was the principal agent problem between the shareholders, investors, and the ones in control. Whenever there's a crisis, we get more rules reducing the principal agent problem, which is good. So what we have right now, the research, the regulation, and the education, it's all focused on principal agent theory. And we have to reduce it in order to create more value. However, if we look at the rules more closely, then we see a change from a focus on disclosure to a focus on predefined one-size-fits-all structures. So this is weird, because now it seems that lawmakers, regulators, and practitioners seem to know exactly how you should organize a listed company. And I don't buy that at all. Because how could they know? They don't know how you sell lamps, what we do at Philips, or healthcare products. They have no clue. So how can they know what's best? And at one point, we will argue in the paper that you will see that the costs outweigh the benefits. So again, we, my co-author and I, believe that corporate governance is about the principal agent problem and reducing it. However, so we should not ignore it. However, at some point, we see that the costs outweigh the benefits. And more people seem to realize this. And they talk about compliance costs, or the cost of capital will increase. We take a different view. We say, listen, it could even have a disruptive effect on the culture, the dynamics, the trust, and the incentives within a corporation. And these are very important to create value to society, to investors, to employees, etc. So this is the argument. Well, we have three cases that we will discuss. Because the corporate governance experts, what they are doing right now at Facebook, they already did before at other companies. One is Apple, and I give you three cases, but I can do many more. But the interesting thing of these three cases is that MIT, I think it was, they published this article in the Harvard Business Review of the 100 best performing CEOs in the world that created most value for the investors. One, Steve Jobs, Apple. Two, Bezos, Amazon. Three, Yun Yong Yong, Samsung. I cannot pronounce Samsung because I work at Philips and Samsung is one of our competitors. Whenever I say Samsung, I get this guy. But I have to admit that they really do well, both the products in for their investors and employees. Okay, we talk about that, I don't know, but they do pretty well. And the interesting thing is, so these are the three best performing. However, if you look at the corporate governance structure, it's really bad, according to the experts. I'll give you just some examples. This is from Steve Jobs' book, his biography. And there's this one section where it says, at one point he invited the former SEC chairman to become a board member. This is pretty smart to have a former SEC member as a board member, of course, a former SEC chairman as a board member. But then Jobs called him and asked him, do you want to become a board member? He was really excited because he loved Apple. But then Steve read a speech that he gave about corporate governance, which argued that boards should play a strong and independent role. Steve immediately grabbed the phone, called him, and withdrew the invitation. And basically said, when you read it, the next page, I don't think you fit in our culture, in our board. Now, basically, Steve shows that he does not really care about corporate governance too much. That's what the experts will say. But yeah, we all know what happened. I think it was Apple did pretty well, also for the investors. There's another example of Apple which I really like. And I take you back to 2003. In 2003, what happened, Steve only appointed friends. You saw that now. If he doesn't like you, he doesn't want you on the board. Because it's, I can understand why. The guy was fired by the board, so he doesn't want to make the same mistake twice. So he is really selecting the best, for him, possible board members. So he calls Al Gore. And he said, do you want to be a member of the board? Al said, yes. And this is from 2003. Corporate governance specialist said, this is wrong. What kind of value can Al add to the business? He doesn't know anything about accounting. He's not a financial expert. You know, he's kind of guy. He's in the media about this environmental stuff. This is a mistake. Apple should not do this. 2003. You see, the stock price of Apple really went through the roof. We all love the products. And I have a different version. A different version could be that he invited Al because he's one of his friends. True. But Al was a... Well, I go too fast. Al was a environmentalist. And Apple had problems back then with their products. They were not environmental friendly. So having Al there, then at least you have somebody on the board that really cares about the environment. So if he's on the board of Apple, but Apple continues to sell environmentally unfriendly products, that would not be good for Al. It would hurt his reputation. So Al had some pressure there to control that. It's a smart, it's also from a marketing perspective pretty smart, but it worked out well. So not what the corporate governance specialist said. So this is Apple. Let's continue with Amazon. Jeffrey Bezos. He did really well for the investors, according to the study. In 97, he wrote a letter to the shareholders. He said, it's all about the long term. And he's now again in the news for other reasons. But OK, maybe we touch upon that later. What happened with Amazon? Well, you look at just at the blue bars, and this is the growth. So the year-to-year growth of Amazon. And you see in 2001, there was no growth. Now investors, as I will show you later, because we have some data, they love growth. If there's no growth, they are going to sell shares. It's not so much about the governance structure, it's more about growth. No growth, sell shares. So in 2001, the corporate governance experts again said, you see, it's not so much the economy in 2001, because that played a role. No, it's the governance structure. It's Amazon's board is part of the problem. It's too clubby. They all like each other. No financial experts. And here you see the board back then. Bezos, Alberg, and Durr, they are two investors. He is an entrepreneur himself. And she is related to Microsoft. And is a friend, close friend of the founder of Microsoft. So all the same view, similar. You can compare this to what you see at Facebook. All friends, all connected in the Silicon Valley ecosystem. And Bezos did not change the board. And what it says, OK, unfortunately, the board doesn't seem to see governance as part of the solution. And if I go back, I think it was right by not changing it too fast, because things went well. So all reasons for Mark not to change, because he has some examples that actually went well, like Apple and Amazon. One more example, just quickly, it's a bit more difficult example that we're going to describe in the paper. It's what was the name? Samsung. And Samsung, they have a weird governance structure, of course. It's all family controlled and chaebol controlled. It's all networks within Korea. There are a lot of networks, but there's also a lot of trust. There are a lot of incentives. The people in Korea are really, they love Samsung. Samsung plays it very smart. What you see right now is there are some new elections coming, and they try to change the corporate governance of the Korean companies. And the question is, should they do that immediately and say, listen, Samsung, what you do is definitely not a one-size-fits-all that we see all over the world. You should change. Others say, no, you shouldn't do it too fast, because that might, again, you know, disrupt the trust, the incentives that play a very important role within Samsung right now. So probably the governance structure and the incentives are the reason why the share price goes up. We don't know. That brings us to some new trends. So are we the only ones that see that we have to change corporate governance? Just quickly, the answer is no. First, the United States, you have the Jobs Act, the Jumpstart Our Business Startups Act, which basically says we create a kind of on-ramp law that gives startup companies to do an IPO some time to abide by all the rules because it might be too expensive. We had a conference here in Canada organized by the business school, and it's called Capitalism for the Long Term. And also there, they say, listen, maybe we have to change the way we think about corporate governance. And what I read on the website, maybe we should focus not too much on shareholder value, but more on the customers and the employees, so other stakeholders, which might be true, but it's a new trend. Then we have some other researchers. This is a professor from Switzerland. And he basically argues the same thing as we did already in January 2012. He says the so-called agency problem, that's wrong. The agency-based research has framed regulation education in a way that's now unproductive and sometimes destructive. So we should redirect the way we think about corporate governance. And then we have a new OECD project, and I'm involved in this. So this you can download from the OECD website. It's called Corporate Governance, Value Creation and Growth. And basically what we say there, I have one article, one size does not fit all, and we should look at different sectors and different phases. So we are not alone in this. But still, we might say, listen, one size does not fit all, but let us be honest, we hear that before as well. That's not new either. And everybody, I think, understands that one size does not fit all. So then the main question is, how can we then link corporate governance to value creation and growth? What should a governance structure look like? Or do we have some best practices? And this is something that we will describe in the paper. And we have some data that I'm going to present to you now. What we do is, listen, yes, corporate governance plays an important role in value creation. And we first have some examples from the non-listed area. This is where venture capitalists are going to invest in startups. And there are people in this room that know a lot about it. But you could argue that governance structures and the incentives that the legal structure creates actually contributes to the growth of these companies. So then the question is, whenever you have an IPO, you change from the flexible contractual governance structure to more rules and regulations based on reducing principal agent problems. Perhaps we also need some flexibility here. So what we do, first we look, we give some examples of the contractual governance structure of non-listed companies. Then we turn to companies that just did an IPO, and then to the more older companies. So we link the governance to the life cycle of a corporation and try to see if we see differences. And maybe Facebook, which is still here, should be organized different from Philips, who would be not here, because that would mean that we're not doing really well, but we are transforming, so we would be here somewhere. So what did we find? Well, first we looked at, we have a database, and we looked at the VC-backed IPOs 2011 to the first half of 2012. We have 70 companies in our database. 41 show, if we look at the 31st of December 2012, a positive, very positive stock price performance, IPO performance. 59 are negative. These companies did very well for society because they created 90,000 jobs, which is reasonable. And age of the companies varies from, the average is 10 years, the youngest 2 years, the oldest is 21 years. You should realize that when you see IPOs right now, that most of these companies are already very old. They are not like what we saw in 2000, that they are only 3 years old. Some of them are like 12 years old, or older. The industries are pretty new: biotech, software, internet, and some services, IT services mainly. So this is the data we have. And then we looked at what could explain the poor IPO performance. Is this linked to corporate governance or is it something else? Well, you would not be surprised, it's something else, because normally when we see a poor IPO performance, it's questions about future growth or lower than expected results. In some cases, you see the lockup expiration, because again, at the lockup, many insiders will sell and the share price will normally drop. However, we see in most cases that the lockup expiration actually leads to an increase because insiders do not sell. And that surprises the market, so the share price will go up again. The growth is interesting because you have some of these companies are pharmaceutical companies, and where they don't pass one of their clinical tests, as soon as that is announced, of course, share price will drop because there's no growth prospect anymore. Or one of the companies was a semiconductors company. They were very important to the chips that Apple used in the iPhone. But then Apple announced that they would change the chips, so there was no work actually for that company anymore. Share price drops immediately because there's no future for that company anymore. At least that's what investors think. And then the company should change that. What's very interesting is that these companies are targeted by hedge funds more than the bigger listed companies. So this is also, if you want to do some new research, that would be interesting. Look at how the role that hedge funds play in these IPO companies. And so the question is, how can we link corporate governance to value creation? And we looked at a data set, but I give you just one example and then I show you some data. This is LinkedIn. And the interesting thing of LinkedIn is it's governed like Facebook, controlled by the founder, classified boards, dual class shares, similar to what we see at Facebook. But investors seem to like it very much. And they do not care too much about, they do care about the governance structure, but not so much about the principal agent problem that is, of course, present at LinkedIn. So what are the lessons that we can learn from, one, LinkedIn, but also the data that we have? Well, lesson number one is investor relations is key. So every company, every listed company, should focus on their investor relations more than they normally do. And LinkedIn is a good example because they even got a 2012 award for their investor relations. And I will show you LinkedIn again. And what we see, something very interesting. There's hardly any research, but LinkedIn participated in quite a number of investor conferences. These are conferences organized by investment banks, like Morgan Stanley, like Goldman Sachs, like Barclays, Bank of America, Citibank, etc. You have to get an invite there. It's on invitation only. They invite investors, they invite companies. But there's a way for these listed companies to get these invites. And whenever you go there, you disclose things to the investors, you explain your growth, and basically you involve them more in the company than you would like to, maybe. The interesting thing again is that policymakers try to engage investors, but there's evidence that they're already very engaged. Now you can go and listen to some of these investor conferences, they are online. And the interesting thing is that the questions that are asked, I don't understand them, especially if it's about pharma or medical. So these investors actually know more about about the product than we think. And they ask questions about growth and prospects. And if you sell your company well, investors will actually like it. The good thing, you see that these investor conferences play an important role in our data set. The average is one every 3 months that they go to an investor conference. Some go more. This is Pandora. You'll see Pandora. They go to 2 investor conferences every month. Others take it easier. We don't know what the best frequency is. There was an article on Pandora. They are there a lot. But they say, listen, we are a 12 years old company. So we have a whole staff. We send the CEO there, and it will not distract them from doing business. When you have a very young company and you don't have a huge staff, of course, you cannot go twice a month because it will distract you from your actual business. So, but they play an important role. Here we see, if you look at our data, this is the IPO, 1 month after the IPO, 2 months after the IPO, who's actually going? And the first month, not many companies go to investor conference. Only there were 9. Most of them biotech and clean tech companies. Then the second month, again, biotech, clean tech, and some services they play an important role. For them, investor conferences are important. The reason is very simple. Why do you think biotech companies have to go to these investor conferences right away? Facebook didn't go. The reason is they have to attract investors. They have to attract or create liquidity and volume. If we look at the data again, we see that the companies that are very frequently go to investor conferences, and this is also per sector, their trading volume is higher than the ones that don't go. And trading volume is the most important thing for these companies to create. If there's no volume and there's no trade in your shares, whenever somebody wants to sell or buy, it has a huge impact on the stock price. So what you see, you have to create trading volume, but nobody knows these companies, especially the biotech. Everybody knows Facebook, Google, LinkedIn, Zynga. But nobody knows about the pharmaceutical company that just did an IPO. They don't even have a product. So the only way for them to survive and to attract investors, and they need this money to actually grow, is participating in these conferences or other investor relation arrangements. Then we look again at the investor conferences we see after 6 months, and then beyond that. We see more and more investor conferences, the older these companies are, the longer they are listed. And then we see that it's not only biotech anymore, it's internet, semiconductors, and other industries that are also very interested in this. The reason why most of these companies go to investor conferences later and not right away is shown here. Most of them go because they have to deal with short interest. So what happens is that hedge funds, as I mentioned, are very interested in these companies. They engage in short selling. And what we see here is the percentage of the public float of the shares that are actually on the stock exchange that can be traded that are also used for short selling activities. You don't want that as your company, because short selling, then they bet against your company. You don't want it as a young company. So what you do, probably the stock price is not right because the information that the investors have is incorrect. In order to correct it, you have to go out there and actually teach them. So investor conferences and investor relations play a very important role for these young companies. Lesson number 2 is the board members. What should the board look like? Well, we need dedicated board members. Now here we have LinkedIn. And LinkedIn is quite similar to Amazon in the early days and Facebook. Here we have the founder, one of the founders, Reid Hoffman. He owns 70% of the outstanding shares, but 63% of the voting. They have a classified board. Here the CEO and the chair is actually different. The founder is the chair, but still it's an insider. And they say, we believe that our governance structure allows us to execute on our strategic plans, enabling us to maximize long-term value for our company and our shareholders. So this is very important. So this is what LinkedIn sells. And basically they tell them, we are not going to change our governance structure because we think about the long term. What if we look at all the other companies? Well, first we look at the CEO and chair. In most companies, the founder is the CEO and the chairman, similar to what we see at Facebook. Then we have the founder as the CEO, founder as the chairman, founder still on the board, or the founders left. It would not be surprising that in the companies where the founders left, they almost all underperform. And the average IPO performance is minus 38. If the founder is the CEO and the chairman, the average IPO performance is plus 16. When the founder is the chairman, you have a different CEO, it's plus 37. But you see that these companies perform actually pretty well. What is interesting is when the founder is the CEO and somebody else is the chairman, that the companies that perform well have a former VC as a chairman. And the companies that do not perform well have a third party as a chairman. Now, this is interesting because here you see what a chair and a CEO is about. Both have an ego. If they don't match and you get a conflict between the chair and the CEO, you have a huge problem in your company. Whenever you have the CEO and the chairman the same person, that conflict will not arise. And in companies where the founder is the CEO, but a VC, and they have some kind of closer relationship with them already for a long time, you have this trust that is needed. So basically, it shows that trust in the boardroom and the dynamics is key. Then we look at the independent directors. Most of these companies have independent directors, on average 76%. But who are they? Very interesting thing is that most of the independent directors are former VCs or founders in the company. And they are independent by law, but of course not really independent because they have something to lose. And we call them in the paper, they are dedicated. They don't go to a board meeting unprepared, like many board members or some board members could do. They just go there, you're not really prepared, you fly to a board meeting, you fall asleep in the plane. You think, oh my God, I only read two pages, but you focus on these two pages, you ask some very good questions, people don't notice that you are not really prepared, and you go home again, you get your 50,000, a good meal, a good sleep, and go back to the other meeting. This happens. These guys actually have something to lose, and what VCs, they use is they have skin in the game. And we have skin in the game, yeah, you are more dedicated. We use the word dedication, not involved, because we really want to show that by being dedicated, that you actually can challenge management. You can basically, you really want this company to succeed. Many of them are business related, so they can help. What you see is they know about the industry. For instance, in a pharmaceutical company, you see many professors right now. Professors that actually know something about medicine, about pharma. And this is good because they cannot read an annual report maybe, but they know the trends in the industry very well. We see 11% are just merely finance and 11% are general. And general we say, okay, these are also CEOs at other companies or former CEOs, so they know how to run a listed company, not necessarily related to the business. So what you see is that it's this mixture that creates the right dynamics in companies and the trust and the incentives. Then we looked at, okay, this was just the average. Here we see, for all the companies that we have in our database, the percentage of former VCs that they have on the board. And normally, yeah, I think one of the conclusions, yeah, having a VC on the board is definitely not bad. What is interesting that in some sectors, like pharma, you see a higher percentage of them. And this makes sense because for pharmaceutical companies, it's more difficult to find good board members that can actually add value. So being or having dedicated board members on the board is actually more important than just having independent directors on the board. And I was at a meeting in Tokyo at a roundtable, corporate governance roundtable, and there was somebody from Australia said, maybe in the corporate governance discussion, we focus too much on appointing watchdogs, not so much directors that can actually challenge management, but more people that look at annual reports. Is there something wrong with the financials? That stuff. These are watchdogs. You need them as well, but you don't need a board with only watchdogs, because that's definitely not good. So this is about the corporate governance in the companies that are just listed. And here we see that having a CEO, which is also the chair, is not always bad. Having involved people that are more involved, engaged in the company on a board is definitely not bad. But maybe this will change when they get really old. So then we had to create some kind of database with older companies. And that's difficult. I had one, but then the economist killed me immediately when I presented something somewhere because they said, yeah, how did you create them? You picked them yourself, so you know, you just wanted to have a result. So you made sure that in your database only companies that showed this result. So I said, okay, you win. So I looked at the FT 500 companies. And now the economist asked me why the FT 500 companies, and I say, listen, this is a database that I did not create. I did not choose them. They are there because they are the biggest companies in the world. When you look at their stock price, their market capitalization. And then they are quiet. So I don't know whether the economist here, you might attack me, but this is just an existing database that we use. And there are what we did. If you look at the FT 500, you see many oil companies and financial institutions. We took them out. Because oil companies, yeah, that's a different company with different governance structures and financial institutions as well. So what's left are more the regular healthcare, telecom, internet companies, etc. And then we see most of these companies perform very well. We have Apple, we have Samsung, IBM. These are the best performing companies. The worst performing companies are Volkswagen, sorry, but yeah, and Telefonica in Spain. So how did they do in 2009, 2012? So after the financial crisis, they did well. They created 788,000 jobs. So this is not bad in a world where most companies are reducing their staff and the number of employees. The average age is 66 years. The oldest one is 175 years. The youngest one is 8 years. Interesting thing is that the younger companies are almost all from the United States, like Google, Amazon, etc. Could be linked to the governance structure. The sectors, also some old food and beverages, some industrials, retailers, even tobacco is here. And then we also looked at their governance structure. Is this really different from what we see in the companies that just did an IPO? And surprisingly, it was not that different. It was not one size fits all. One other thing that we looked at, if we look at these 50 companies, they're all very much involved in innovation and value creation. Now, there are several ways to look at this. One is patents or R&D spending. What we did is we looked at their corporate venture capital departments and how active are they, how many investments did they make in younger companies, and how many partnerships did they create with younger companies. To give you one example, Samsung is very active in the area of corporate venturing. They invest in many, many young companies around the world. They set up corporate venturing activities in the United States, in Asia, and in Europe. So that's how we measure them. It's completely new. It's different, but I like it more because I think it's more realistic than looking at patents, because I work at a multinational and we register many patents, but not all these patents will create value. So by looking at this, we have a different view, but I think more realistic. All these 50 are very active, and here is just some of them. Apple, you see Amazon, you see Google, you see Intel. And Intel is an interesting one because Intel, their stock price dropped in 2012. They were punished by the investors because they were too slow in embracing mobile devices like smartphones and tablets. So they stayed too long with the PCs. So what did they do? To give you an idea of what we measure, they set up an ultrabook fund. So they put aside some money, and now they're investing in ultrabooks in order to catch up with the other companies that are better in mobile. Also, you have a Brazil technology fund, an India technology fund. So they go to emerging markets and try to find opportunities there, that's one, and creating a market there. To give you one example of food, it's Unilever. a Dutch UK company, which is very good, is outperforming Procter & Gamble right now because they were the first to go to the emerging markets. So this is also related to value creation and growth. And that's what you see when you look at this corporate venturing. So that's why we think this is really interesting. Now, if we look at corporate governance, then surprisingly, very active in the investor relations and very active in investor conferences. Not so much to create volume, as I explained, for these listed companies that don't have any people interested in them. They have to go out there, find investors that are interested in them. They already have a lot of interest, but they go there and then ask the question, why are they going there? Not to create liquidity. The reason why they go there is they explain to investors their growth opportunities. They will meet young companies that they can partner with. So you meet peers, etc. The interesting, give you two examples of companies that did this very well. One is a Dutch company, ASML. ASML is a Dutch company. It's a semi. No, it's a. It's a chip. They manufacture machines that manufacture chips, and there are not that many. And when they had their fourth quarter results were published, share price went down a bit. But then they immediately start calling investors and explaining them that they had some new innovations that would take over the market, and immediately their share price went up, and it was the highest ever. So here you see that investors really believe in growth. But sometimes these investors do not really understand what you do, so you have to explain it to them. A similar strategy is now pursued by HP. HP is not doing really well, but they are also going out there trying to explain to the investors what they are doing, and we will see whether this has an effect or not. If they have a good story, share price will go up. If it's a bullshit story, of course, the investors will not buy this. But going out there and explaining things to investors, explaining how you are transforming a company, for instance, is key. So investor relations, it's one of the most important things. I'm almost there, I'm right on time. Then board composition. Well, in 50% the chair is the CEO. And this is not what the experts want, of course, and these are the best performing companies in the world. Or the chair is the former CEO. Or the chair is another insider. In Japan, sometimes they have as a chairman a CEO of a subsidiary. Which is definitely an insider because he can be fired by the CEO and he should control the CEO. So from a corporate governance principal agent perspective, this is weird, but it works. In only 19%, we see that the chair is actually independent. And this makes sense because I had one book when I was writing this. I found one book that was written by a director of IBM and Merck. And he actually explained that having a CEO and the chair as the same person can be very beneficial because you don't have these conflicts of egos that I explained. And I kind of believe that. So you should be careful with just appointing an independent chair. You should really get a good match with your CEO. Otherwise, it's probably better to have the same person there. Board composition. Well, again, independent directors in 70% of the cases. 50% of the independent directors are general, former CEOs or CEOs. 60% are the so-called watchdog finance. But what we see more and more is that venture capitalists are taking board seats in these companies, which makes sense. If they try to find startup companies to partner with, you could have a VC on the board that actually knows that market really well. And you see more and more business-related ones, like professors that know an industry or are otherwise involved in that business. So what we expect that in the future, boards will look more to boards of like a good match of people. And actually, this guy that wrote the book, for him it was an eye-opener because he always believed that you should have former CEOs on a board. But then they introduced a Merck professors, and he describes that that was really, really powerful and helped them grow. So the conclusion, should Facebook change if we know, if we look at the data, if we do the analysis? Well, at present, they should not change their governance structure, according to me, because that would actually show that they are only interested in the short-term investors. Because the short-term investors, they want to change, and whenever you see a change, share price will go up. Because they will see, see, now he's changing, it's more than one size fits all, but you will not have the long-term growth, so at the end it might go down again. What the future could be, if we just look at Facebook, Facebook did not participate in any investor conference. It's one of these companies. It's understandable because they did not have to create any volume. These shares are sold every day like crazy, still bought and sold, so there's a lot of liquidity there. However, they might have neglected the fact that these investor conferences are also there to explain to investors what your plans are, what the future of Facebook is that he has in mind. And interestingly, tomorrow they go to the first investor conference ever. It's the Morgan Stanley Technology, Media and Telecom Conference. So now it's wait and see what they're going to tell the investors tomorrow. Thing is, they are going to send the CFO. And most of these companies, when they go to investor conferences, send the CEO. There's a huge difference because the CFO will probably talk about financials again, whereas the CEO might talk more about future plans. So maybe that's something that he should change. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I see we have, because I have this one-hand watch, so I can only tell you the approximate, it's approximately Wednesday, yeah, this is a German Meistersinger watch, but it's good because you're never in a hurry. No, we have some time according to my watch, so questions, comments. But now we need a mic or something?
Thank you for a very interesting talk. I have a question. When you're talking about Facebook, first of all, how do you see the context in which Facebook is a kind of a startup company, which in a way quite different from Philips?
Yes.
But it seems that you're putting them at the same consideration for governance, for corporate governance. So the first question is, how do you see this distinction?
No, I don't. The interesting thing is, I don't see them as the same. Because they are startup companies, as I told you, we have different phases. The thing is that if you talk to the experts, and if you go to corporate governance conferences, or the education or research, there you have this one-size-fits-all. I definitely do not believe in a one-size-fits-all, and that's actually why I'm involved in this research, because that cannot be right. That was my idea. So Facebook should be governed differently. Then we did the research and we looked at the IPO companies and we see, yes, these boards are different because you have many VCs still involved. You have more dedicated directors involved. So that probably should change when you are bigger. But if I then look at the 50 best performing companies in the world, then I don't see that many differences because they also adopt the strategy of we need a board that's actually functional, that can actually challenge management. We see companies in France that has really controlled by families. We see a brewery in Belgium controlled by the family and they really outperform. And if you look at the board, the directors that they appoint, they are somehow they can add value. So, yes, they have former breweries there that actually understand the industry, or they want to expand to a country, and what you see is they're going to appoint a China specialist on the board. So Intel, for instance, did this. They want to expand to China, appoint a China professor in Chinese, whatever. From a corporate governance perspective, this is weird because, you know, she doesn't, or it was a she doesn't know anything about the financials probably, but she can explain or at least challenge the board whenever they are going to expand to China, whether it's right what they do or not. There are many companies, many listed companies that made huge mistakes, like Danone when they went to China, huge mistakes because they did not understand the culture. Then having somebody on the board can actually help. Then to finish this story, most people that I talk to, in practice will say, listen, you make one mistake in your analysis. The innovation will never be done at the top, right? These guys are not going to register any patent. These are like R&D departments that are somewhere out there. But then my counter argument is, it's all about the tone at the top. Tone at the top are the words that you hear everywhere now in listed companies. So whenever you want to have a company where really innovate fast and bring their products to the market fast, and you look at their board, somehow the board and the top management create an environment where other people can excel, where other people are respected. So for instance, Google, when they were young, just listed these engineers. I think they had 20% of the time they could do whatever they want. Just they could do whatever they thought was right for Google. And that helped. A lot of innovations came from that. IBM, when you are the head of a department, but this is a story that I hear, so I have not checked it. Whenever you're head of a department, you know that your department will exist for only a limited time. So whenever you're there, you have to already think about what you are going to do next. So create something new, disruptive, because it's all about a disruptive technology and being fast, innovation, if you want to survive. And if you really want to have a good stock market. So Apple is an example because people expected growth. We had new products. We had Steve Jobs there. Today, we are going to reinvent the phone. And we all thought he was crazy, but he was right. Then he came with the iPad. We all said, man, this is a ridiculous product because where can I put my USB stick? He makes a mistake, but he was disruptive. Now we have new CEO, and we're all waiting for this new. We see new products. We see iPad 5, iPad 6, iPad 7. But it's all built on products that are already out there. It's not really disruptive. It's innovative, but not disruptive. So if you want to be disruptive, you have to create this environment at the top, otherwise it's never going to happen. And I know this also a bit from practice. So you see differences. They should be treated differently, Facebook and Philips, for instance. However, somehow these best performing companies are organized in similar ways. And that makes it interesting. And also in the US, you see more and more control companies that are family controlled or use dual class shares. Comcast is one of them. Walmart, family controlled, is doing really well. So probably a structure with some dedicated or involved shareholders, dedicated boards and management that create the right dynamics is the key for future growth. But then again, we have to be careful because one size does not fit all.
So if you think one size does not fit all, could there be industry-specific sizes?
Yeah.
I mean, could there be a tech type of corporate governance, whereas a pharmaceutical type industry corporate governance?
You have to be careful, but probably you could, I hate the word best practice, but you could find some particular ways to organize your company. For instance, in pharma, it's pretty common to have professors on the board that know pharma very well. And by the way, they register most patents as well in new medicines that have to be created. So they need pharma in that respect. I really like because they always knew they have to in order to innovate fast, they have to partner with small companies. Whenever they use partner with a small company, there's an incentive problem because the small company might be held up by the bigger company. So they came up with fantastic ways to make this really work. So that's why I love looking at pharma. To give you one example, they created now a venture capital fund, GSK and J&J, investing as anchor investors in a VC fund together, but they are competitors. Which is weird because normally you would say, no, that can never be right. But they found ways to deal with it. And I think in that respect, it's a very good industry to look at. But then again, probably a food or a retailer or tobacco, I don't know whether you can structure the same way as a pharma. So being more sector specific or having more sector specific research is very valuable and key. But you don't see it that much. That's what I hate.
Hi, I have two questions. The first is related to Dell and whether or not you could comment on Dell's developments in this framework.
Yeah.
And the second one is, I understand that you've been looking at the correlation between corporate governance structure and success.
Yeah.
And to what extent the structure contributes to success. But I'm sure it's also the case that success also contributes to corporate structure. Like, I know that.
Definitely.
Because obviously, if a corporation is doing poorly, they're more likely to throw people out. Like Steve Jobs, he didn't just leave. He left when they were doing poorly at the time. I was wondering, you know, to what extent does that also contribute? Whether success leads to corporate change in a corporation?
That's a very good observation and question. To start with that one first, because then we have to define success, and we try to link success to future growth. Because if you just look at stock price, there are too many other things that might influence that. And then what do you need to actually get future growth? And you need to innovate. The term open innovation is out there for a long time. It was introduced by Chesbro. But to be honest, no company really understands how to do open innovation. So we have a lot of books on open innovation, but not on how can we do the open innovation, how can we structure it. The companies that we look at actually found ways to do it. And that's how we link it. And then I believe at the tone at the top. And then what we see, because we make observations, we see indeed that these boards are structured in a different way than we all think they should be structured. That's the first step of this paper. And of course, I hope that we will find more things. Dell. I have to look at Dell, what the specifics are. Dell is not part of this database, so I have to be very careful here. I know what the developments are. I think that's good, by the way, what's happening there, because obviously they were losing it. They were not fast enough. Again, looking at Dell and its success, they were just not fast enough in innovating. And if you compare a Dell computer to an Apple, it's that you cannot even compare it. And at Philips, we had Dell. Now we changed to HP. And I got an HP computer like not even 1 year ago. And I have a MacBook Air that's 5 years old. It's the first generation. And when I open it and I look at just the screen, it's, oh man, you think that a Dell is 20 years old. Oh, the HP. It's the innovation. And I think both HP and Dell had problems. They just stay too long with a successful product. And that's interesting because at Philips, give you one example, we sell lamps. And before the LED, very successful, you just box lamps to your customers whenever they needed a new one because these things are going, they break down. But the LEDs, they last so long that you have to come up with new business models. I think both Dell and HP have problems there. Intel as well, because last year they underperformed. But I think when you look at the structure and what they're doing right now, and you link that also to the board structure, their interest in China and in emerging markets, I think they will perform well. But you should not post this because then next year people are going to check it and probably they underperform and see, you see, this guy is no good. But if I'm right, you should post it. So we wait 1 year and say, you see, this guy can predict the future because he looks at governance structures. Actually, doing this research, it took me, told Pierre already, 2 to 3 hours, 3 hours per company to find all the specifics. I had to go through the CVs of all these boards. But you learn a lot about them. And some people hate Microsoft. But when you look at how Microsoft is organized and what they did, I think they will do well in the future. And actually, it's what you see right now. They get better and better. But I think it's we have to redirect. I think that's the main lesson. We have to redirect the corporate governance discussion, because this principal agent theory and only focusing on that, that's not how you run a business. Any other questions? Ah. Yes.
I mean, it's interesting that you raise it because there is
if you have to, you have to use this. It doesn't amplify battery.
Okay. There is the Harvard Corporate Governance blog, and today they sent out a new post that talks about Apple being hammered by activist investors.
Yes.
And it would seem as though if you couple that with a recent blog on the Harvard Business Review, that talks about the recent dual class share structure, IPOs, etc. It would seem as though that these companies have learned the lessons from the last tech bubble and are trying to shield themselves from the corporate governance industry.
That's an argument that you hear. And Apple and the hedge funds right now, this is interesting. I think Apple, I think what investors want to hear is, where are we going? I think that's not particularly clear. And if you do not communicate that well to your investors, then this is what's happening. Because then people get insecure and they say, listen, we don't see any innovation, we don't see anything, so share price might drop, and then they will bet against your company. Now, Apple will survive, obviously. But the main question is, will Apple be the innovator as we know it, or will it just be a regular, company, an older company? If you look at the life cycle, that, you don't see real growth anymore, but it's basically becoming a normal run company. I don't know. I think if they really believe that they have new innovations coming, they should be transparent. And I can give you one example: LinkedIn. And I didn't mention it, but it's nice. If you look at the startup companies, the IPOs, and the investor relations, LinkedIn is very good, and they have an investor relation officer that really believes. He views himself, as he says, an independent person between LinkedIn and the investors. So he blogs and he uses Twitter and all this stuff. But the investors really like him because he's so open and honest. Then you look at other companies that all underperform, and I have five examples. They use, as an investor relations officer, they don't have a separate person, they use an agency. And they use the agency for the IPO, but also after the IPO, they kept using this agent. And probably not so much involved, and the share price goes down. It's all about the communication to investors. And for these young companies, it's very important that they have a good communication to the investors, because they need these investors to actually get the money to grow. Whereas Apple doesn't need shareholders to grow. They have a lot of cash, and these shareholders want to get it back. So it's a completely different world. That's also what you have to keep in mind, and comes back to your one-size-fits-all. Attracting investors as a young company, a pharma company without any product, and you need the money to go to the third stage of clinical tests, is different than a Siemens that has a lot of shareholders, and also different how you communicate with them and interact. So yeah, all these examples that you use, and the Dell that was mentioned, and your Apple, it's very interesting, but I have to do it to see how these stories will fit in what we find. And maybe we can tell them, okay, this is what they should do differently or not. One last short, okay,
short,
that's you.
Yeah, short question. So you mentioned LinkedIn and Facebook. And while LinkedIn have, in a way, changed her model by going with the job posting and all that, Facebook is, some say it's a dead horse. But both have the same governance structure. So how do you see the connection between innovation and corporate governance, if at all?
Yes, you ask very good questions. I think both companies are innovative. And if you look at the boards and the VCs that are still involved, I think both have a huge potential. LinkedIn went down, it went up. Investors, because there are some articles out there and they interview investors, say that because LinkedIn was very clear to the investors. So investors knew what they went into. Facebook, on the other hand, the communications to the investors, that's where things went wrong. There's a whole report right now why the stock price went down, right? Because they were not listed, but they were traded at the shares post and the second market. And I wrote an article with somebody else on this. And there we predicted it, that with Facebook, what could happen is the communication and transparency to the investors. So the institutional investors at the time of the IPO had more information than the retail investors. They were warned that, okay, maybe it's not as good as we all thought it was, so they did not buy and actually sold shares, where the retail investors, they did not have the information. They thought, okay, you know, more like herd behavior, let's buy Facebook shares. Price went up at the IPO, and of course, now everybody realizes that it was not as good as it was, you know, previously said it was, so share price goes down. It went down more than it should have, to probably, you see now, it's going to stabilize. And the reason is that right now they show that because they had some problem with the advertisement in mobile products, etc. They focus on that more, they change it. And as far as I know, the long-term investors really believe in Facebook and believe that the investments that are made right now will create more growth in the future. So probably if Facebook did a bit more investor relations like LinkedIn, what we see now would not have happened. But that's easy for me to say. But if they get more active in their investor relations, and it seems like they are going to, we will see that share price will go up again. So it's the communication, and that's why we have this word dynamic. So it's the communication, the interaction with investors, is the interaction within the company, the board and management. That's what we should focus on. But that's very difficult to do research on. But that's real life. And how we see the cooperation with investors, they're all passive, they don't know anything, and they're with management, and management per definition steals, because that's what we all believe. So we have to come up with rules and arrangements that make that prevent them from stealing. That's not how most corporations are run. So we just try to get a more realistic view of a listed company. I think this is it, right?
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So it's approximately 2 o'clock on my watch. That's good.
Thank you again for being here with us. This is just a token of appreciation for your time. And I'd like to thank Professor Zimbansen for inviting Professor Vermeulen and giving us this opportunity to hear about it. And I'd like to thank the PTTP International Speaker Series for allowing us to have such good food today. And thank you all. This talk will be hosted on our website, www.oscg.ca. So check us out, and thank you.
And you'll get a link to the paper as well. So
great. We look forward to it.
Yes,
thank
exactly.
You.
Thank you so much.